Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be here with you all and to talk about these amazing things and to share some spirit time. Hey, Ron. How you doing, buddy? To share some spirit time together. So our plan is we're going to talk a little bit about the work that I've been doing, and then we'll take we'll take a little question answer period, and we'll take a break, and then we'll come back and we'll have an experience. We'll do a hypnotic regression. We'll go to a past life and beyond, and we'll have some interesting adventures. So, as Rich mentioned, I am a clinical hypnotherapist. My office is in Claremont, up the road, about 30, 40 minutes, depending on traffic. 45?
2 hours.
2 hours, yeah. I've been there for about 14 years now doing this work. And, I was really drawn to the whole reason that got me into hypnotherapy was really past lives. I was fascinated with past lives. I was always fascinated with other times and other places, and I felt that, I was drawn to certain parts of the world and certain eras in our history. So I just wanted to explore that. So eventually I wanted to learn how to guide people to past lives. And hypnosis and hypnotherapy is a great way to do that. It's not the only way, but it is a pretty reliable method. And so then I had read Michael Newton's book, Journey of Souls. It's a great spiritual classic book that goes beyond past life regression into the life between our lives. And I'd read that maybe in the mid-90s, and then I found out he was training people. And so I took that training, and boy, that really changed my life quite a bit. It opened up my whole practice. It opened up the whole concept of past lives. It's just the tip of the iceberg, really. And so I've really been enjoying that quite a bit. So let's talk about life between lives. What is that all about? And how do we get there? Maybe we'll walk through a typical session. When someone comes in and they might have some issues in their life, maybe relationship issues or career questions or health problems, what have you. We'll have them bring a list of their personal questions, this kind of thing. And we'll talk about, they'll come in and we'll talk about, what they're looking for in the session. And then I'll talk to them about hypnosis and hypnotherapy and how that works. I'll give them some tips about how to get the most out of that. And we'll do that today as well before we do our group regression. And so when it's time to get started, we'll, cut the lights down, light some candles and stuff, and we'll get started. We'll do a hypnotic induction, which is just a fancy way of saying getting a person relaxed and in the zone, and getting them to close their eyes and begin to open the doors, open the gates to the other parts of themselves. What we're really looking to do is to access the soul's memories, not just the memories of the human being, which are probably in the brain or whatever, but we're going to access the soul's memories, because as we all know, I think, in this room, we are more than just a body, more than just a physical organism. There is some kind of essence or energy or soul or spirit which animates this body. And so that's what we're really looking to access in these sessions, the memories of the soul, memories of other lifetimes, memories of our existence between our lives. So So we'll do the hypnotic induction, kind of get those doors open, the doors to the soul. And then we'll do some kind of memory warm-ups to help the person get in the groove of talking and remembering. Dr. Newton is the one who originated this process, Michael Newton, PhD. He, as Rich mentioned, he stumbled upon this process through some of his psychology clients. And so through trial and error and over many years, he developed a pretty great framework to take just about anybody into the life between lives. And so we follow this framework of his, this structure that he made. Everyone, you know, it's not one size fits all perfectly. We have to adjust and customize to some degree. And, you know, that's kind of part of the fun of it, is going off and seeing where a person's going. But basically, we will do an age regression. Well, we'll take a person sort of down a stairway of their life. Like if they were 50 years old, we'll count back, you know, 49, 48 years old, deeper, deeper, getting younger and younger. And then we'll stop at a couple ages in childhood, maybe around 12 or so. And then we'll stop and we'll move off the stairway and maybe go to their home and go to their bedroom or something like this, get some details about their life as a kid. And then we'll go back to the stairway, we'll go down a little deeper, maybe till 7 or 6 years old. Maybe find yourself outside doing something fun. And again, it's all memory warm-ups, getting them kind of in the backwards mode of going back in time, back in time. And then we'll go back to the stairway, and we'll go back all the way into the womb before they were born. So we'll go back into the, you know, when they were just a fetus growing in their mother. And there's lots of amazing information to be found in there. Because, gosh, at some point, after conception, at some point there's going to be a child, there's a child growing, and there's a soul which has been assigned to that baby. When I say assigned, I don't mean he's told that he has to go and be in that one, because that is a very interesting process in itself. We actually choose our lifetimes in concert with advisors and counselors and this kind of thing. As souls, before we incarnate, we have like a pre-life planning session where we look at the state of our soul. We look at the qualities that we're wanting to develop. And we look at maybe more than one possible lifetime to see which lifetime might offer the opportunities to stretch and to grow and to challenge us in those particular directions that we want to grow in. Say, we need to learn, we're having trouble with forgiveness or something, so we'll choose a life that we might get stabbed in the back a couple times, and we'll see, you know, do we really have it in ourselves to forgive and to move on. So we have many lessons and many qualities that we want to develop as souls. And so in this pre-life planning session, we will explore that, and we will be advised. And we'll eventually make a choice. And so in our session, when we're looking at the soul, we can find out, when does the soul actually first visit that fetus, that baby? You know, at what time is that? Sometimes it's like within moments of conception, they first come in and they say, wow, it's dividing. Oh, okay, this is going to be me. I mean, it's just like 4 cells, 8 cells, 16. So souls can come very early just to see, like, bang, yeah, it's on. you know, this is gonna be me, you know. Sometimes other souls are sort of busy doing other things for a while. Maybe they'll pop in 3 months and go, okay, it looks pretty good. And then they'll go back out and have other adventures. Because we have a lot going on as souls, and we are multi-dimensional beings. We have a lot going on in many different realms. And so at some point, we need to kind of park ourselves in that baby. Although then, again, there are some clients who kind of move in and out a lot. They'll move in the baby. They'll say, okay, this is who I'm going to be. They'll get the feel of how those muscles work and the neurons and all this kind of thing. And then they'll go out and do other things, whatever adventures they're having. Then they'll come back in a couple months later. I've had some clients who don't actually fully enter that baby until after it's even born. Like, I don't really want to go through that, bloody, painful thing. You know, we'll just let the mother and the baby sort of do that, and they come in. I'll come in a couple days later. So, some people don't like to get their hands dirty. So it's very interesting. You know, it's very fascinating that it's so different for every one of us, and for each time that we incarnate, it's a different path. It's not always the same. You know, it's so different. So, and depending on, you know, so many factors and variables, it's always a different experience. So this is really fun in our sessions to explore this with a person. Now in the womb there, we can also get a lot of fascinating information already about why the soul chose this life and this body. Why it chose this family and this neighborhood. Why it chose, like say, the body. Maybe the body has certain qualities, like it's very athletic, or it has some infirmities, or this kind of thing. There are reasons for all of this, and we can explore this in our sessions. So it's quite fascinating. Another fascinating aspect of the soul coming into the fetus is that sometimes the soul energy can actually perform modifications on that fetus, particularly on the brain or the nervous system, this kind of thing. And we encounter this from time to time where the soul will say, this is a pretty good specimen, but I need to tinker with its mind a little bit. I need to open up its brain. I recently had a fellow who was saying, I'm going to insert packets of information in this baby's brain, which are going to lie dormant for like 45 years, and then when I need this, it's going to, well, I'm going to open it up, and I'll have this information at my disposal. So it's pretty amazing what souls can do. So moving through that womb process, we'll finish that up. And then we'll take a person into a past lifetime. Like we mentioned, a previous lifetime, a previous incarnation that we have lived. Hopefully one that is connected to our life today. So we can learn from that experience, learn from that past life. It's very fascinating to just look at past lives and say, whoa, you know, I was a farmer and, you know, I had 20 kids and wow, that was really neat. But I mean, how is that connected to now? That's what we really want to do. So we'll look at a lifetime, usually an Earth lifetime. But there are other places in the universe. It's a very big universe. And existence is very long, if not forever. So, you know, Carl Sagan would say there are billions and billions of stars and this kind of thing. And
billions and billions.
There you go. Wow. Thank you, Carl. Tell me what to say. The ghost of Carl. And Our scientists are finding like planets like every week. I see on the internet, found another Earth-like planet, you know, in sector XJ3 or whatever.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing. And so the numbers, you know, the numbers are incredible. They're like trillions, there are billions of, how many stars are in the Milky Way galaxy? Like 20 billion?
Something 200 like? Billion.
200
billion.
Billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy.
100 to 200, but more like 200.
How many galaxies are there that we're aware of?
At least as many as that.
So.
At least as many.
So the numbers are incredible.
We can only see 3/4 of them right now.
There's a lot of stars and a lot of worlds, and we don't even know, you know, like you say, other dimensions and other universes. So there's a lot of opportunities. This is great. There's a lot of opportunities for us to come and have these physical lifetimes and even quasi-physical incarnations. Some worlds are maybe more of a mental world or an astral world or an emotional world. Maybe they're not purely physical like this, but there are lots of physical places. So, anyway, we have lots of opportunities to have amazing experiences. And this is what we love to do as souls. So, in these past life regression part of our life between life sessions, we'll explore this lifetime that we lived. We'll explore the personal relationships that we had. We'll explore the conditions, you know, was I poor? Was I wealthy? How did I deal with that? Either way, all these kinds of things. We'll look at some of the milestones, you know. What did the person do? How did they spend their time? What did they do? What was the theme of that life? Was it all about service to the community? Was it all about personal growth? Was it all about looking after, you know, a family member, this kind of thing? So we'll look at those past lives and eventually we'll work our way, we'll go backwards, we'll look at the childhood, you know, the adulthood, and we'll work our way forward to old age if you make it that far. And we'll move to the last day of the life, and we'll look back on the life, again exploring the theme of the life. And then we'll go to the last day and the death, and we'll observe the death, and that's a very interesting thing. And so we'll go through the death experience. And again, that is very different for each of us and each time that we do these regressions. And each time we do a lifetime, these experiences will be different. So when the person dies and the soul rises up, this is when the life between lives part of our session really begins. And so as you've explored in these near-death experience studies and all the speakers and things that you've had, there are lots of ways that people cross over. There are some common themes, you know, like in the NDEs, right? Like moving through a tunnel, seeing a light, maybe a being come to meet you, this kind of thing. And we find similar things in our life between lives sessions. Although we find a great gamut or a great spectrum of different experiences. A typical experience will be like a person, the soul sort of rising up from the body, and I'll ask them, how are you feeling now? What does it feel like to die? And it, overwhelmingly the response is like, oh, I'm so relieved that's over. Because living a life is a struggle. It's tough. You know, we have these physical needs, hunger, you know, survival, belonging, you know, acceptance, and all these things, love. And so leaving that life is always a bit of a relief for a soul. It's kind of like maybe taking a really, really hard class, like in college or something. Something that really bends your mind, you know, like calculus or something. You finally pass that class, you're like, I don't care if I got an A or a D minus. I made it through, you know, wow. So it's a great relief to be done with these lives. Welcome.
Thank you.
You're most welcome.
Sorry to be so late.
Oh, no worries. No worries. Thank you for being with us today. So, crossing over, lots of experiences. Sometimes a person will need to take a little rest period. You know, it's interesting. We're going to shift from the physical world into the spiritual dimension. So there's a shifting of frequency. There's a shifting of vibration that our soul needs to go through. Thank you. And so sometimes people need a little time to make this shift, to make this adjustment. And so sometimes people will sort of say, you know, I'm moving, but now I've stopped, and I'm just resting, and that's perfectly fine. Sometimes people need way stations, you know, to take it in steps, to go shift into the spiritual realms, into the spirit world. And so we'll take our time, and sometimes if people are taking a rest, I'll talk to them about the life they just lived. Maybe they need to process some of that information and look at that. So we'll look at the life, and, you know, I'll help them to shed some of the heaviness of the earthly experience. So kind of like, you know, taking off your clothes at the end of the day and dropping them on the ground and saying, ah, I'm free now. So we'll take some time to do that. That's perfectly fine. And so eventually we will shift into the spiritual realms, the spirit world. And there are many experiences to be had. Often, a being will come to meet us. Usually a spiritual guide, sort of angelic figure, will come to meet us. Sometimes it can be a loved one who has preceded us in death, like grandpa or mom or, you know, Uncle Joe or something like that will come to meet us and say, hey, you know, welcome, you made it. You know, you're going to be okay. I'm going to take you here or there, something like that. I've had a few times where it's sort of just like an impersonal attendant comes to, like a nurse when you go to the hospital or something. Someone takes you into the waiting room or whatever. Someone will escort you. So we usually have some kind of help when we cross over. But I'd say most often it is our personal spirit guide. We have spirit guides of different types. We are all sort of assigned spirit guides. We usually have one primary spirit guide who has been with us for a long, long time and will and knows us better than we know ourselves, really, knows what we need to learn, has the ability to look into our soul and see what is needed. And so this spirit guide will often meet us as we enter the spiritual realm once again. And we'll sit down with that guide, and he or she will orient us to the spirit world once again, because we've been away for a while. It's sort of like an amnesia type of thing, like, oh yeah, now I remember who I really am. So, because when we go down to Earth, into the earth life, we sort of take a drink of amnesia because we need to focus on the particular task that we're doing. So when we come back, it's sort of like, oh yeah, you know, wow, I remember who I really am, and oh, my friends and my teachers and this kind of thing. It's really cool. So in our sessions, we'll sit down with the spirit guide. We'll talk about the life that you just lived, the past life. What did you accomplish, you know, what maybe wasn't accomplished, And that's okay. Talk about what did you learn and these kinds of things. Overwhelmingly, our spirit guides are very supportive and very positive. Even if we didn't accomplish what we set out to accomplish, they're still pretty much like, ah, it's all right, you'll get them next time, kid. You know, at least you got in there and gave it a go. So they're really, it's a loving experience. And sometimes they will sort of enfold us in their energy to help us acclimate to the spirit world. It's a beautiful thing to see in these sessions where my client is reliving this situation where they're re-meeting their guide and they're rekindling this relationship that has gone on for eons. And the guide is just, you know, cradling them in this divine love. It's a beautiful experience. And the client can be very, very touched by it. There's lots of tears. And tears of just emotion and love. You know, on Earth, in our lives, to feel such a pure emotion, we don't get it all the time. Love has conditions sometimes, unfortunately, and so to feel this unconditional acceptance and love, like no matter what, I love you forever, it's a beautiful thing. So it's a beautiful experience to be able to share with people. And so we'll do that orientation with the spirit guide. And then they'll probably have other things that they'll want to show us. We'll have other things that we want to do. Often they will direct us to go to a place of healing, of restoration. Because we've been through this earthly experience, they want to restore our soul energy to its full power. So we have these places of healing in spirit, and they take many different forms. People perceive them in different ways, kind of in earthly ways. A common scenario would be to go to a sort of a temple of healing, and there's a chamber, and you lie down on this slab or something, and there's light coming from all directions, and it's filling you with energy. It's restoring your soul's energy. It's amazing. And so in the sessions, watching these people laying on the couch and just like the look on their face and their body, you know, it's just like they're glowing. It's incredible. So even while they're reliving this memory of having this spiritual healing, before they were even born in this life, because of the now nature of time between spirit in the spirit world and the unfathomable connection between spirit and earthly life now, it's like they're reliving it. It's like they're getting healed all over again in the office. So it's an amazing thing. It's an honor and a blessing to be able to watch these healings. So it's really fun. They could take other forms. I've had people describe it as, well, I'm standing under a shower of light, you know, where it's rejuvenating me. It's washing the mud of earth away from me, and it's cleansing me, and it's restoring my energy. I've had people have healing, so popped into my mind the first time I had a session like this, when I died and everything from the past life, and I went to this place kind of like Roman baths, and it was like this classical place, and there was a few people around, and I thought I'd just kick back in this bath for a while and chill out. That was great, really comfortable temperature and everything. So that was my healing experience. I've had other people say, "Oh, well, I'm in a field of daisies and I'm playing with bunnies or something," and that's what's really healing for them. The sun's shining and the flowers are smiling, and you know, everything great. So it's different for everybody. And it's just a really fun part of our session. Once this healing restoration takes place, the client becomes even more more fully immersed in the soul and the soul's memories. So it's a good move to do in our sessions. So then from after the healing is accomplished, I usually talk to the spirit guide and ask them, you know, what do you think this person needs to do? And there are many, many interesting station stops in between our lives in these sessions that we can do. One very important station stop or experience that we can have is to go before a panel of very, very wise and exalted beings. And Dr. Newton calls this the Council of Elders. And these are beings who are maybe a couple steps beyond even a spirit guide. Wise beings that don't even incarnate anymore. They've evolved in such a way that they don't incarnate in physical lives. But they are giving this service of helping these younger souls to evolve and grow and this kind of thing. So we'll go before this panel of souls, and basically for an evaluation of the life that we just came from. And then again, because of the simultaneous time, we can use this in our session to talk to the elders about the current lifetime and the current situations. And they will give us all kinds of information about the current life. So it's an amazing thing. Like I mentioned, we'll have a client bring in a list of questions. And usually during this Council of Elder meeting, we'll address the council and ask them, we'll run down these questions, and they'll basically answer these questions. The way we, bless you, the way we work this is to, the really cool technique that we have is while the client's relaxed and in hypnosis, we get them to basically channel this information. So this information is coming not from me, it's coming from the mouth of the client. So I'll just say to the client, I'm going to speak to the elders or the guides directly. I would ask them to place their responses in your mind or even through your voice. Is this okay with you? And they'll usually say, sure. And I'll ask the guides or the elders, is this okay with you? Will you speak through the client? Sure. So the client's basically channeling this information. And it's just an amazing thing. So this is the favorite part of my work, that I get to talk to these wise, loving, compassionate, exalted beings, these spiritual beings, through my clients. And that's basically what I live for, you know, in doing this work. I get to rub elbows with, you know, very high souls. It's a great honor. And but I will question them pretty hard. I will put them through their paces, and you know, because I'm really, they understand that I'm working for my client. I'm trying to get as much information from my client. So this Council of Elders can also take many forms. It's very fascinating. A typical form would be sort of, you walk into this sort of sacred building. And it has a feeling of sacredness about it. Maybe like a dome or a temple or a cathedral or something like this. And, you know, the people, even as they walk in, they have a feeling of awe because these beings are so wise and powerful. Kind of like, you know, going before the throne of God, although they're not quite that high. But it's an awesome feeling. So the clients will stand before these beings, and this is what we do between our lives. We stand before these beings and we talk to them, and they'll look at us. And they can read our souls, and they can tell us what we need. They can tell us, you know, you've done A, B, and C really well. We're so proud of you. You know, and that just makes you feel great. And but then D, E, and F, you need work, kid. And so we're gonna send you. We're gonna set up some more lives for you, and we want you to work on these things. And you're like, okay, I will. I'll do my best. And so it's a really fun part of the session to be able to get this, to access the wisdom of the heavens, basically, for my clients. And then towards the end of that conference with those elders, a really great question that Dr. Newton has is to ask, you know, why was Joe brought to this session today? What does he really need to get from this experience? And they'll say, well, you know, we helped him. We dropped that Journey of Souls book on his foot in Barnes & Noble. And we wanted him to, you know, seek out someone like you. Just like that. We wanted him to seek you out because he's not listening to us. We're trying to get through to him. And this is a good way that we can get through to him. Give him a course correction about his life. So this is really, really fun. So after we finish up with the Council of Elders, we might do many other activities. We can explore, just like a hall of records, you know, a great library, or what we might call the Akashic records. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we can go to this place and consult the records. I recently had a client, I think just last week or the week before, where they wanted to go to the library, and they were given like a great book. And this book is a book of all my lives. And, you know, I can look in this book and see where I've been. And the book might even take the form of moving pictures, you know, like video. It's kind of magical. It's a magical situation. So it's not just like, you know, turning pages. It's like watching scenes from other lives. And so it's an amazing thing to explore the Hall of Records or the library. You might even, souls might even want to research certain subjects or things that they've been working on. Maybe they're science-minded and they want to get information about physics or something. Maybe they're artistically minded and they want to get information about techniques or this kind of thing. So all knowledge is available to us, you know, in these sessions, and we can bring this back. We can bring this back. We can touch into spirit and bring this information back. It's incredible. So another important stop that we make in these sessions and in between our lives has to do with soul groups. We have soul groups just like we have families on Earth. We have groups of souls who are brought together at some point and kind of bond into a family of brothers and sisters, this kind of thing. Become very close and tend to incarnate together in lifetimes over and over in various roles. So these soul groups could comprise anywhere from 5 or 6 to 15 or 20 members or more. Then we'll have outer, larger groups and affiliated groups, which are next door. And we'll also usually have a kind of inner circle, maybe 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 souls that we're really, really close to. And so in these sessions, going and meeting with your soul groups again is a really, really fun and emotional moment for people. Because it's like meeting with your long-lost sisters and your brothers and this kind of thing. And so these are your peers, people that you've been incarnating with. Maybe this guy was your mom in that other life, and then in this life it's your daughter, and in the next life it's going to be your best friend, and this kind of thing. So we have these really close relationships with souls, and we have these soul groups. And so again, in the sessions, it's really fun to commune with our soul groups. Again, it's a feeling of unconditional acceptance and love. Now we can talk to some of these soul group members, again, having the client sort of channel that information. We could have soul group members come up and talk to the client one by one. And we'll talk to those soul group members and say, you know, who would like to come forward and talk to, you know, Mary today? And someone will come forward and they'll say, you know, hey, you did great in that life. You know, we're so proud of you. And this kind of thing. And then I could also ask them questions about Mary's life today. I'll say, Nancy, from your spiritual perspective there, how do you think Mary's doing in her life today? And Nancy will give information about this. You know, she takes things a little too seriously. We wish she'd lighten up a bit. She needs to get out and smell the roses a little more, and this kind of thing. So we get all kinds of information for clients in these sessions from all these various beings and avenues. It's an incredible thing. About soul groups, I will just talk a little bit about, there are different types of soul groups. You know, like when you were young in school, like in elementary school, we just have one class, you know. Mrs. Miller is our teacher, and we have 30 kids, and that's our sort of group. So when we're young as souls, we generally have this kind of one soul group. But then, like in our lives today, as we go into junior high and high school, we take other classes. And so as souls, as we grow and develop, we will make affiliations with other groups. We'll still have our sort of homeroom or soul group, our home soul group, which Newton calls the cluster group. But we might also spend time in this working group. Like maybe you'll have an interest in healing. So we'll go and spend time with these souls who are interested in healing, and we'll have a teacher and we'll work on each other and this kind of thing. Or maybe you'll have an interest in music or art. So we'll have another group that we'll go and do crafts with and play with frequencies and vibrations and color and sound and this kind of thing. So there's lots of different groups. As we progress, we open up. We open up and take more classes, so to speak, and make more friends, you know, make other affiliations. And so after meeting with soul groups, there are other things we can do still. There are things that Michael Newton has written about. There are things that come up in sessions that he has no idea about, because every soul is so different. Every person is so different. So I've had people just do incredible things that I never heard of before. Like, I remember with Rich, we had a client that she went to kind of a music center, like a celestial music center. This is a person who was an actress and a musician. And so she goes and visits this kind of celestial music hall and like gives a concert to these other souls and this kind of thing. So everyone can have these individual experiences in these sessions and in our life between lives. Another thing we can do between our lives is take field trips to other dimensions, other planets, other worlds. Maybe we'll take a trip to a place to learn about manipulating energy, using energy and forming things, this kind of thing, or using energy to heal. So we'll take field trips and this kind of thing. And I guess as the sessions tend to wind down, we might want to go and revisit that time of pre-life planning to understand why we chose the current lifetime. You know, why am I here now? What am I supposed to be doing? I've kind of forgot. I mean, I kind of have this feeling I like to do this, that, and the other, but I don't know. Am I totally off track or what? So we can, in these sessions, we can go to this pre-life planning sessions and meet with all those counselors around that table, kind of like sitting around a library or something, and we can revisit that and say, oh yeah, I wanted to have this relationship with this soul for a certain time in the first part of my life. In the second part of my life, I really wanted to work as an aerospace engineer because I'm fascinated with science or exploration of space and this kind of thing. And then in the third part of my life, I wanted to give back to my community by volunteering at a homeless shelter or something. So we can go back and look at the plans that we made and the reasons why we are here now. And so it's just great for a client, a person, to go back and look at, you know, why did I come here? What was I thinking? Yeah. What was I planning?
What was I thinking?
Yeah. What agreements or contracts did I have with other people? What soul contracts did I have? Did I honor that contract? Did I finish that up? You know, did I finish up that karma kind of thing? Did we clean that up? So, you know, it's a really, really cool thing. So, by this time, it may have been 3-4 hours, maybe a little longer. And the sessions are quite lengthy. And, you know, I don't know how other therapists are, but I can't charge by the hour because I don't know how long these things are going to go. And they have a life of their own. So I've had sessions maybe 3 hours. I've had sessions maybe 6 hours. So it just has a life of its own. And it winds down naturally. And again, I'll talk to the spirit guide who's been with us through this whole thing, hopefully. And I'll say, what else do we need to find today? And they'll usually say, maybe this, or maybe they'll say, and we'll go do that. And then eventually they'll say, she's had enough for one day. We're good to go. And so we'll wrap up the session. And so it kind of winds up naturally, and the person, you know, will bring them back to normal waking consciousness. And they've been laying there for hours. And so, you know, they may be a little woozy as they get up. We'll help them to get up and everything. There's no rush in getting up. Give them a few minutes to kind of come back to themselves. And if they want to talk about what they explored, we'll be happy to do that. If they want to just be quiet and just let it sink in for a while, that's fine too. Whatever they want to do. And so the cool thing is that as they walk out of the office, they know that they've had some kind of, you know, amazing experience. It may not have all sunk in yet. There's just so much information and so much experience that they've had. So these sessions are so deep and so far-reaching that it could be weeks, months, even years before it fully sinks in and you fully understand all of the import of what you learned on that afternoon. So, you know, you need to take some time with it. Take some time and let it sink in. And I or my colleagues are always available to, you know, talk with you after your session about that and help you process it, help you integrate it into your life today. I should put a plug in for the Newton Institute. The website is newtoninstitute.org. There are over 200 therapists worldwide who have been trained in Michael Newton's Life Between Lives techniques. And the training is pretty intense. And the entry requirements are pretty stringent. So these people are pretty trustworthy, and most of them have been doing it for years now, so they're very experienced. So even if you just wanted to get a past life regression by someone, I would probably go to the Newton Institute to find someone that has this background in life between lives, because it deepens and informs your past life regression in such a way, in a spiritual way, that maybe your average past life regressionist just doesn't have. So, that's about it. We audio record the sessions, and so you'll basically remember most or all of what occurred, although over time it will slip away kind of like a dream. So then I can email you sound files or even burn CDs, and so you'll have a record of that experience, you know, for the rest of your life. Now, I've just had a client who got inspired to create an LBL transcription service. So there's also going to be a way that you can pay some money and get like a written report of your session, which is pretty cool. And I'll just say it's called lbltranscription.com.
Very creative.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
I want to know how long do people spend between lives, and what are the variables? I mean, is it longer after difficult lives? Things like that.
Also, really interesting. That's a great question. A very interesting question. How long do people spend between lives?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it varies, and it also varies through
minimum to max.
It varies through history too. Say like 10,000 years ago or 20,000 years ago, when there wasn't much change going on, or say 30,000 years ago, when we basically, you know, were kind of living a caveman existence, a person might go 1,000 years between lives because there's not much going on.
How do you know?
How do I know what?
It's 1,000 years.
Well, because we've asked people and they've told us.
Yeah, there's not technological change.
There's not much advancement going on. Say between 30,000 years ago and 20,000 years ago, not too much different.
Well, in Atlantis, maybe.
In cultures. Right? Well, it depends where you are, of course.
Yeah.
But look at now. You know how fast things are changing.
Well,
and we find a faster turnover rate now.
People are
coming back within 2 or 3 years, you know, something like that. Yeah. So to complete, you know, complete the answer to that question, it varies. Mm-hmm. But I think when the times they are changing, you know, we come back a lot more often because it's just more exciting, and there's more to do. I was just asking this question the other day to a client. And what they explained to me from spirit was that, yes, time does exist in the spirit realm, but the parameters of the physics are so different, you just won't understand it.
Right.
Wow. So it does exist in some form, but the parameters of the physics, you know, are so different. My teacher's named Dick Sutphen, a past life pioneer, who's still teaching and doing seminars. He described, like a glass chessboard with like maybe 100 chessboards. And on each chessboard is one piece. Say this life you're a queen, and this level you're a pawn, and this you're a bishop and everything. Now if you get down and look through all of that, there's like a whole game going on. Mm-hmm. And so, that's sort of our existence, you know, this whole pageant of movement and things. And so who cares which is 2015 and which was 2000 BC? It's just all part of the game.
Part of the symphony,
yeah.
I understand in a single lifetime, we get traumas and you have to like work those through and work out forgiveness. But on the grand scheme of things, where are these souls going with that healing? Is there ultimately, like we're still working on, at some level, are we gaining experiences? Maybe it's just trying to gain new experiences and enlarge our understanding of all that could be experienced. I'm just wondering, what would you say, is there an arc to the healing?
Well, I would say definitely the last statement was a beautiful statement, that we are just looking to grow and expand our awareness, mm-hmm. and expand our compassion, expand our wisdom, expand our experience and this kind of thing. When we talk about healing in these sessions, it's because the soul has come into an earth body and has experienced particular things, maybe abuse, maybe physical abuse or emotional or mental abuse, or it got twisted up somehow. And that does affect the soul energy. Mm-hmm. It's not immune from being touched by what you experience here on earth. You are touched by that, or why would we even do it? Mm-hmm. So you are touched by that. And so when we go back, our soul may be a little bit, bent out of shape, and it was a little twisted by, what had happened, living through, Hitler's time or something, or something really horrible. It's going to warp you in some way. So that's what we're talking about in doing healing in between lives, is to recover from these earthly experiences, then to restore your soul to its natural state of health. Does that make sense? Does that answer your question?
Is there an end goal? It sounds like kind of growing up or becoming more mature, or just, beginning from not having very many experiences and then being able to understand a lot more. So this increase of awareness.
Do you want me to take a shot at that?
Yeah.
Just from research that we've done together. He's taken me to some healing classes. Somebody said it, I thought it was a sort of a wonderful way to put it, is a canvas, a painting of who we are as a soul. It contains so many different colors, like a fantastic canvas that you and your spirit guide may have gotten together and said, now, what's your canvas going to be? Requires all kinds of colors, all kinds of shades. Some that we here might consider dark or negative or unhealthful. But all those shades are part of that big portrait. So healing in terms of getting your energy back into a particular place so that you can add that color to your canvas. So healing on an individual basis, everybody has to go through that so they can get their canvas in the right dimension, if that makes any sense. It's not healing per se. However, there are reports where people say that the healing light of the universe, they actually call it that, is what doctors and shamans and healers on earth call upon subconsciously to help them in their work. But the caveat is, not everyone signs up for a lifetime where they get healed. And not every doctor signs up for a lifetime where they heal everyone. So it's a little bit like a painter with canvas and trying to get the colors right and trying to heal the person that they're trying to heal and the person trying to be healed, or coming upon the idea that I want to be healed, let me try that. I'm changing my contract. Mm-hmm. But because it's individual, the end game would be you particular, your portrait of who you are and how that all pans out, if that makes sense.
The word, the word healing, I think it's affiliated with the word whole, holistic and that kind of thing. And so healing, I think, also pertains to balance and wholeness and this kind of thing. So when we get knocked a little off balance and that thing, it just, putting us back into that sort of cosmic blueprint of, perfect health.
What's the end game for the next level?
Yeah.
Well, I had a spirit guide say that he had gone through all of his lifetimes and all of his journeys, and his graduation gift was me. And so that was his gift. And so then, so then he and I worked out what my portrait was going to be, my canvas was going to be. And when I go through all my lifetimes, whatever long that takes, I'll graduate. I'll move from my affiliated group into another group. Eventually, I'll be sitting on your council and judging you. Now, whatever it is, whatever my path is. But yeah, that's the end game. The end game is to move up, to graduate from your class, to keep going back, I guess, until you get back to the source. And start over again, or who knows,
That's the end game, is to get to the source.
The end game.
But is there really an end game?
Is there an end game? Is that
to move close to the love?
I don't believe there is an end game.
I don't.
We can debate this, and we, and that's okay. I don't believe there is an ultimate end game. It's like when you're traveling over hills and then, oh, you get to the top of a hill, you're like, oh, I didn't know that other hill was there. I couldn't see it from where I was. Mm-hmm. So the further we get, the more we see what we don't know. And I think it's a never-ending evolution, personally.
But that's a personal end game. And I think there's also the concept of a sort of universal end game, meaning what are we all doing together simultaneously? I mean, that's a personal journey. Sure. But the overall reaching one thing that I heard was that idea that the universe is sentient, that everything in the universe is sentient. So we learn from our mistakes, but the universe learns from our mistakes. That's pretty deep.
Whoa.
So that the universe as an end game is just making us all go together. There's an old Brahman concept in Hinduism where there's been this, something they call kalpa, and it's the universe expands and then all these experiences happen and then at the end it contracts.
Right.
And then it starts over again.
The breath of the universe.
Yeah, and they say there's been 12 so far in their religious concept, and who knows? Talking about time, and we were talking about time and space and distance, once you're outside the parameters of this realm, it's like getting out of the fish tank, stepping away from the fish tank, and now you can look back at the fish tank, but outside the tank, linear, non-linear, not so important, but in the tank itself, you can observe what's going on. But so, for example, in a session that we filmed, a person lived an entire lifetime as a captain of a British ship, 25 years old. And when she got back to the Between Lives realm, she was returning to her classroom, which was waiting for her, which had been waiting for her for that entire lifetime, which she said felt like 5 minutes. She said, it felt like I went out for a smoke, and now my class is waiting for me. So if you extrapolate that just for a second, okay, if 25 years is 5 minutes, so then 2,000 years, not so long, like a movie, like a two-hour movie. So characters that showed up 2,000 years ago, Jesus, whoever, really was only here 2 hours ago working on that movie. That we can't feel it that way, but they do, you see?
Yeah.
So those characters that keep showing up in our history, maybe that's not so weird. Maybe that's just normal. You know, like the guy walking back and forth in front of the movie theater. Oh, there he is again. You see? So that stepping outside of time is a way to help us realize, yeah, there's a million things that we can and should be doing, but also we're okay. What we're doing is the right thing to be doing.
Well, okay, but I would just say, once again, what is the end game of existence? I don't think there is one. Even if there are those kalpas, I mean, if this is the 12th, or, I mean, it's going to be 13, 14, 15.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
20 million. I don't think it really ends, but
well, you would
I could
know.
Be wrong.
You would,
he would know.
Time and a half.
Yvonne has a
yes,
question.
Ma'am.
Okay. Go back to like negative souls and
what
healing.
What does that mean, negative souls? What do you mean by that, negative
people
souls?
Who have done crime.
Oh, okay.
And that type of a thing, and jail, they go and reform themselves and become a higher understanding, that type of a thing.
Uh-huh.
So I wanted to know how that kind of works in the spirit world type of a thing. And the other question I had is, if you're on medications, for physical medications, mental medications, how does that actually play in with your soul in the next life?
Okay, so first question being, if someone does some, you know, negative acts.
Murder.
How does, then what? What's, then,
well,
if they do that, then?
How are they, how do they reconcile that with themselves become a higher
okay.
soul?
Okay, that's a good question. Basically, if someone does negative acts, I mean, what's negative? I mean, I don't know. That's putting a judgment on something. I mean, obviously, to kill someone is probably not a good thing. Although, you know, maybe there could be a circumstance where it was the best thing you could do. I don't know. It's beyond me. I can't judge that. But I understand what you're saying. If someone does something that they feel was wrong and they're ashamed of and this kind of thing, what do they do? Well, between our lives, we will review it. We will go back and look, and we'll say, we'll sit with our guide or something, and we'll go, let's do a life review, and let's see, you know, what did you do? Right here, let's stop. Right here, you had a choice. You could have put the gun down and walked out of the liquor store, or you could have done this or that. You decided to hold it up and steal the money. You know, that was a choice that you made. You know, what do you think about that? And they'll say, I was desperate, but, you know, I probably could have done something different. So basically, by looking at the actions and talking it out with advisors is how we learn, you know, that maybe we could have made different choices. And they can also play these scenarios. Hey, let's have fun. Let's see what would happen if you would have put the gun down and apologized and walked out. How would your life have changed? And they'll create this whole new video of, you know, wow, look what could have happened. You'll be like, whoa, you know, I could have become president or whatever, you know, I didn't know. So these are some ways that we can learn is by reviewing things and getting some counseling. And then we'll be given another chance to make that sort of similar choice. Another lifetime, that sort of thing will come up. Now, did we really learn that? Did we incorporate what we talked about? I don't know. We'll see what happens. Okay. The other question was?
Medication, people, how does that affect people?
Oh, if you're medications.
Mm-hmm. Especially psychotropic meds.
Or even heroin.
Okay. You know, I haven't really explored a lot of that with guides and that kind of thing. I would tend to think that if a person functions better on a particular medication, it's okay spiritually. Don't feel guilty about it or anything like that. If you know, if you could wean yourself off and use natural remedies, that might be probably better for your body and that kind of thing. But as far as judgment or anything like that, someone's going to get mad at you because, you know, you were on a pharmaceutical medication or you were addicted to heroin, no one's going to get mad at you.
Even the Council of the Elders?
No. But there's just acceptance, and they're going to just talk to you about it.
That's what I always question.
Okay. Well, I would say we don't have to come here. We don't have to do anything. No one is forced or coerced to do anything. You're not forced to incarnate. We are clamoring to incarnate. As the souls that are not incarnate are like, they're like, oh man, I'm so excited. I am ready to go back down there again. It's like going to Disneyland because you get to sense, you get to smell and taste and feel. Up in the spiritual realms, we take these lectures and classes, and we can learn all of these wonderful concepts, you know, these ethical concepts and metaphysical concepts. But it's all intellectual. Mm-hmm. It's all mental. We come down into a body to test it, to feel it, to live it, you know, to see if we really learned it.
Not sure, because once we're here, we have no memory of what it was that we're here to do, kind of, sort of.
Well, that is also part of the plan, and some of us do have memories of past lives. Some of us do have memories. We determine, you know, how much are we going to remember? 3%. We're going to remember our spirit. 0. We're going to remember nothing. We're going to remember 50%. Every person walking around here, and at different parts of our lives, have different amount of feeling or remembering who we really are. But for the most part, most of us take a pretty big drink of, you know, forget juice or whatever. And so, because we need to focus on this task. If we're thinking about all these, remember that Roman time? Oh, dude, it was so awesome when you were the emperor and I put you on fire. And, If we're thinking about all these, you know, the crazy things we can't focus on, hey, I need to take care of my daughter or whatever. Just to cap that off, we don't have to come here. We choose to come here because we want to test what we've learned. We also want to experience viscerally life. Souls can, again, they can learn many things upstairs, but they don't really progress in the way that we do when we come into these earthly incarnations. We accelerate our advancement. Because how can you really know anything until you've experienced it? You know, like if someone was losing a child, you have compassion. But until you've lost a child, you don't really know what it feels like. So we come down here to feel what it feels like to live and have these experiences. Yes, absolutely. Earth is a beautiful, amazing place, but it's just a speck of dust in the universe that
we talk. When you regress people, have they been outside of?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You have, okay.
Yes, many, many, many people take other lives and incarnations in places other than Earth. Mm-hmm. Other physical worlds where the bodies may be kind of humanoid, you know, two arms, two legs, that kind of thing.
Right, right.
Bodies may be, there are water worlds where people are like dolphin beings. Mm-hmm. There are other worlds where people fly in these crazy bodies or whatever. So the universe is huge, and there's lots of amazing.
That's why I can't imagine only coming here, back here.
No, I'd be boring.
Really quick question.
Yes.
How many years does the human race on Earth have left on Earth? Have you got any information on that from anybody?
Yeah, we have 10,533.
2 hours.
I have
no idea. Well, there's a lot of information you're not supposed to know.
Yes.
Right? And so there's stuff that would just, it's sort of beyond the capacity of the human brain to comprehend, mm-hmm. and would cause and engender such fear. Mm-hmm. That it wouldn't be worth letting us know that information. I'm just saying, sometimes when you ask, well, why aren't you telling me this? And the answer is, because you're not supposed to know. So, right. You know, I don't know if Scott's ever had anybody. I know that in Newton's work, he talked about people seeing lifetimes in the future on Earth where there was like the cities were smaller and people were more rural. You know, he kind of describes that in general terms. No, not specifically what happens.
I've had a few people that flipped into future lives and describe various scenarios, and you know, I don't know what to think about it. But I would get with you just in a second. I would think that if you look back on the history of, you know, humankind, and we don't even know. I mean, what do we really know about that? We think Homo sapiens kind of developed maybe around 200,000 years ago. Or something like that.
Lucy goes back to 6 million, mm-hmm.
okay.
but
that's not
our
almost
species.
Say, yeah.
That would be
almost
Cro-Magnon. Our species is Cro-Magnon, and that would be about they say 40,000 years roughly after Neanderthal. Neanderthal was like 200,000.
Okay,
we're about 40,000.
So that's 40,000 years. So I mean, in with our technology and everything, the way the world's progressing, I mean, who knows what will come up in 50 years or 100 years or 1,000 years from now. I'm a science fiction fan, so I have to think that we will eventually be branching out into the universe. Mm-hmm. We'll overcome the distances and the distances between stars are immense. But I think we'll find ways to overcome this. I mean, so gosh, who knows what the future holds? It's up to us. Every decision we make, you know, in our life changes and alters that. So I'm hoping for the best.
The pattern is that everything is speeding up. The universe is expanding faster now than it ever has expanded. And each species of life, of human life, has been longer in the past and shorter in the current. And like 40,000 years is nothing. 200,000 years is more. Before that, it was like a million years. Some of those other species that led to us. Or as long around for like a million and a half years.
I have a, you know, I had a client tell me recently that I'm not sure if I should divulge all this, but this is the 39th iteration of this species. It's sort of planned, it's seeded. There are creator beings, and there are other beings that are helping us and working on us and this kind of thing. And so, I mean, will we evolve? Will there be a new species? You know, like you said, the species are changing and the time's getting shorter. Yeah, I mean, who knows what we'll evolve into and what will happen, but it's fascinating to think about. And as souls, we're already doing it. Right. So on some level, we'll have to do some future progressions one of these days.
Yeah.
And live whatever their life is, but for some, do they change their mind? Is that what the suicide is about, or is that part of...
It's always different. There's not one answer. Some people make a plan and they're going to live to be, you know, 68 years, but then the life turns out really poorly and they just bail. And so they just, we have free will. Even though we made plans, we can always turn left instead of right or just cut loose. And other times I've had clients where the suicide was a plan. Because it had to do with other people that were around them. It was to give a lesson to those around them, a lesson in loss. Not a fun lesson, but it was sort of a plan. They were going to leave when they were 17, when they were a troubled youth and this sort of thing. So, and then on the other side, how are suicides handled by the elders and the wise ones and that? They'll just talk to the soul and say, you know, hey, we made this really great life for you and you bailed out. You know, we're a little disappointed in that. We're not going to spank you or demerit you or anything like that, but we want to talk about this. Yeah. And, you know, next time you want to take a life, I mean, you're going to have to show us that you're really going to stick with it.
So. Okay, let's think about a 10-minute break. Okay, great.